Step up Biza and let the people them know what going in at the heavy metal world right now.
Hello everybody, welcome to the very first part of our story of Eternity in Your Arms. I'm Beast from the That's Not Metal podcast, powered by Marshall. We're here at Marshall HQ with Will and Ian. So, let's pick this up at the beginning of the writing process for Eternity in Your Arms. When did the songs start coming together for this? I think there's this weird, like, I don't know if it's a misconception or not, but like when a band is releasing EPs, there's this theory that exists where you go, they'll be saving the best stuff for the record. Mm-hmm. Were songs from Eternity in Your Arms written a long time ago and been held for this long form release, or was this literally like, as each release has come, what we've got is the songwriting in that time period?
We definitely, I mean, obviously Misery carried over from the, it was on The Strange, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But we never, the way we set out to write a record is as like an individual, it's an individual project. Like we never think beyond that. It's always like one project. Mm. So we'll sit down, won't we, and we'll write out the ebb and flow of the record, and then we'll write to that template. And we never really think beyond that because we get so involved with the creative process of that project, don't we?
Yeah, I think like a lot of the time in the past, we've been songwriting and the little ideas will be here and there. Mm. And we're like, that's not quite really worked for this EP, so we'll keep hold of that and come back to it later. But we kind of exhausted all those little things by the time we got to our third EP. Three EPs was enough time, we had 15 songs at that point. And so we'd exhausted all that, and it was trying to work out how to introduce a brand new audience to this who never heard the EPs. Because when the first record you ever, the first band you ever liked, you know them from their first record. You don't know them from the first EPs they have. The EPs almost at this point become redundant. So you have to kind of think about how to introduce yourselves all over again. And at this point we'd exhausted a lot of the material we'd been writing from. And we're not a band, like putting Misery on this record was a long conversation. You know, it wasn't something we're like, oh, that's a really obvious thing to do. Looking back on it, it is an obvious thing to do, and it came from us wanting to extend the life of that song. Because after a while, you have to stop playing things live. Like, we can't do a whole album's worth of songs and then play three EPs worth of songs as well. This doesn't fit into a headline set. So by putting Misery on that on the album, it meant that we could keep that going. But other than that, like, I think most of the parts are fairly new on the album.
Yeah. Mm. What came first, the narrative or the songs? Like, were you writing, because to my head, if you have a narrative, then the songwriting can be fit in to fit all of those moods and areas that the story goes into. Mm. Or the songs start coming together and then the narrative is kind of taken from the skeletons of those songs. Which one of those was the case?
I think all those things are...
Was there a bit of column A and a bit of column B?
I think they all kind of runs on like three different timelines. I think... we've been doing the narrative was in place long before we got into the even writing into the songs
record,
or even
started
thinking about the album. We knew what the end goal was
because it was preluded by Calisart and The Stranger. It was leading up to that,
so we knew where it was going. But in terms of like, the lyrics are on one scale, and what sort of songs you want to write on one column, and the music's in another, and then there's a narrative in the other as well. And the lyrics and the narratives you might think kind of gel together all the time, but also it's very difficult to just write narrative songs. And with a band like us, we try to make the songs, I try to write them from a place that's very real and very authentic. So we're not like going out and lying to loads of people every time we play. Like we're trying to write about real things and real experiences, so it takes a long time. I think a lot of the time, it was a mixture of things. A lot of the time I would record an idea on my phone and in like notes or whatever, and that would be an idea for a song. Or I'd sit at my piano and really badly play a chorus. And other times we'd have a riff and we went from there. Like
It always starts with like a seed, doesn't it? Like, and then it kind of blossoms from there, so to speak.
It took quite a while to do because I feel like this is the first record we've made where we didn't really have, other than Misery, we didn't have anything before. We had to start all over again.
Total blank canvas.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Would you describe Eternity in Your Arms as a concept record?
The whole nature of the record, I like to think that it's kind of, it's for the listener to decide. People keep asking me, we were doing press this week in Cologne, and they were asking me what their album title meant, and what their reference is from that. And I kind of just feel there is obviously a very clear meaning to it. We wouldn't just choose it for no reason. Mm. But the idea is that where is James Scythe? Where the narrative ends up? That's kind of all in the eye of the ear of the listener, I suppose.
Yeah. So your lyrics are written by you, obviously.
Yeah.
So Ian, what is the title Eternity in Your Arms? What does it mean to you then? As the person that hasn't got the official say on what it is, like someone within the ranks who's super close to it, what does Eternity in Your Arms mean to you?
It is an ambiguous thing, and it is open to interpretation.
Well, what's your interpretation?
Honestly, I have two interpretations.
Okay.
One, I feel like, in a way, it's a message to the people that follow our band. It's a way of saying, this is something we've created, and anybody can become invested in this, and this is, for eternity, this can belong to you, you know? Mm. There's that.
Good tie-in with the Calatar as well.
Yeah, exactly. And there's also there's so much to it. Because we talk about this all the time. There's also the James Scythe story of his wife dying, and there's that loss and the eternity of that whole scenario with Mary. Just dropping names, everybody knows what they are, but it's probably just us. But even to me, personally, we've spent a long time working on this band, our whole lives, really. Mm. And to me, there's a personal thing of, this is going to last with us for the rest of our lives. It's almost like there is going to be an eternity of this. Even when the band split up, if the band split up, beyond that, this record is going to last forever, you know? And it's... I don't know, it just feels like a little gift, present.
Well, that's fair for everybody.
Yeah, no, but it will, it's out in the ether, isn't it? Anybody can access
absolutely.
It at any
you
point,
can find
you know?
It at some point, yeah.
So even if you don't know about us or you do know about us, it's going to be there forever, you know? Mm. But like I say, it's open-ended. Anybody can have their own interpretation of it. Mm. And I think that's really important because it gives power to people that want to make their own decisions, you know?
Absolutely.
I wouldn't ever, and I know you agree with me, I wouldn't ever want to be this
it means this.
This is how it is. This is what it means. If you think otherwise, you're wrong, you know?
Well, this rules because we have comment sections literally for this. Let us know what Eternity in Your Arms means to you. The Stranger and the Calatar were elements that have weaved their way into this story, large elements as part of your history and part of your narrative up to this point. Mm-hmm. How do you, when did you decide what those characters, what their fate would be with regards to Eternity in Your Arms?
I think it was quite easy. I've been writing for a long time from the Jay and Barry Peter Pan story, and because we felt a kinship with the idea of floating out the window and trying to escape, and I think that's why. I think escape is a really common theme throughout my life, all my life. We were talking the other day, literally last night at the hotel, talking about when we were younger and what we did when we were younger, and I was talking about how I spent so much time on my own when I was younger, my parents not being around and things.
Yeah.
And so, and I think a lot of people who get into alternative music and into subculture in general are those people who are just very isolated. And when you find a community of people who feel the same way you do, it's incredibly important. I think that was a turning point for me. And I learned so much from subculture. I went, from meeting different people and understanding and empathy for people who are different beyond different music as well. You know, something on a much more important level. So I felt running away from things has always been a theme in my life, especially when I started doing music. When we were kids, when we were teenagers, we started touring, and now I'm 29, but I've been doing it all this time.
And we were literally talking yesterday. There's a little story about when I was younger and my mum washed my mouth out with soap. She pinned me down, washed my mouth out with soap.
What had you done to...
This is where this is going.
Uh-oh.
Okay. And talking about escapism, this was literally a physical form of... I had ran away. I was like, I'm done with this. I ran away to the forest, like just down the road from my house. And I tried to survive, like for a couple days in the forest. My mum had no idea I was. I ran away.
Ian Miles and as Bear Grylls.
That's where he'll end up. He'll end up in the woods.
I was found by a dog walker.
Oh my God, you're kidding.
No, I found a hut. I like, bearing in mind when you're younger, you've got all these crazy ideas of what reality is. I found a hut. And it had axes on the wall, and the axes were covered in blood. I was like, "Oh my God, this is a weird horror movie."
Why were they covered in blood?
It was a hunter's hut. Like they hunted pheasants and cut their heads off. Yeah. And anyway, it was really wild. Like it was a really wild experience I had when I was younger. And then my mum found me, and she. Anyway, but yeah, it was always
and
about.
You swore at her. That's why she washed your mouth.
Yeah. I said, "I want to get away from here, Mama." Yeah. And then she pinned me down and rubbed soap in my teeth.
Yeah.
But anyway.
That was yeah.
I wish it did. But yeah, that's like a genuine want to
form
escape.
Of escapism.
Yeah, you know, and yeah. I think that's what.
That's yeah. We went, that was made for
a tangent.
Yeah, that escalated quickly. That's what that was made for. Suddenly yeah, we're on bloody axes.
This
in
is
wood,
what it's
sure.
like being with you all the time. Yeah. So extreme. So. Escapism has been really important in both my lives, and being the band being the most obvious one. So the Callous Heart was obviously the first incarnation of that. Mm. I was trying to give a physical patch, like a gender neutral Lost Boys, and we went on from that. And I ended up finding like incredible parallels in the narrative of Peter and Wendy, the original screenplay, to our lives. And as I looked, kept looking more and more into it, I found more and more and more. And so by the time it came to write the album, we knew a Captain Hook character was not only going to be added to the story, was actually more close to how we are now than the Callous Heart.
Where we are in our lives right now.
That human who's grown too old to be young forever and is constantly chased by time. And that's a lot more where we're at now.
That's interesting because I'm older than both of you guys, and it's the Callous Heart that appeals, that applies to me more, because I'll never lose that sense of escapism.
Yep.
And the idea that, like, even listening to you here talking about like what you were like as kids and that level of like, I used to just throw myself into things because that's your way to escape. Mm. Like, make it, letting me know that not just you in this conversation now, but like everyone who's related to the Callous Heart, it really makes me feel like I'm not as weird, especially like being my age now and still being like, we've spoke a million times, we've never spoken about anything about our personal lives at all. It's always just been the things that we're into and all the rest of it. So we will be talking more about Eternity in Your Arms tomorrow. Come back for more part two of the story of Eternity in Your Arms. I'm Bees from the That's Not Metal podcast. This is Marshall, whom we are powered by. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and catch us every single Friday on iTunes and SoundCloud on the That's Not Metal podcast. See you tomorrow for part two. That's Not Metal is powered by Marshall. Join us for new episodes every single Friday featuring the most honest reviews, savage opinions, and everything you need from the world of rock and metal. Go onto iTunes or SoundCloud and search That's Not Metal and subscribe today. Premium podcasts are available at thatsnotmetal.net. Come on over there and get our very best work. thatsnotmetal.net for premium podcasts. That's Not Metal, powered by Marshall, available on iTunes and SoundCloud.